All right, we finally come down to it, and today we are going to finish up my Telecaster here. It's pretty simple. I'm just going to clean up the fretboard, treat it with some lemon oil, polish up the frets a little bit. Going to restring the guitar, then set up the B-bender, and then set up the guitar. I've got to reset the intonation, all your typical stuff, set the pickup height, and then that's it. From that point on, it's completed, finally. And then I got to figure out how to play a B-bender. I will definitely do, as a separate video, a sound demonstration. I might just plug it in briefly just to hear it ring out, because I haven't played it in over a year. I'll at least give a little bit of a demo. I'll be a complete hack at doing B-bender licks, because I don't know how to do them. So I'm complete B-bender noob here at the guitar, so it will be very interesting. Anyhow, let's get it finished. First thing on the agenda here is I'm going to protect the pickups on my guitar, because I need to polish these up with some steel wool. And steel wool is not necessarily good for the health of your guitar's electronics. So the easiest way to resolve that is you just cover up the pickups. A little blue painter's tape. Mainly the steel wool, fibers are going to want to stick to the electromagnetic field of the pickups. I don't like getting that stuff everywhere. And you could do this with other things too. Use polishing cream, like Flitz or Autosol. All you really need to do is just make sure you've got the guitar protected properly. I know people that would gasp, "Oh my God, he's using steel wool on his electric guitar." It ain't that big a deal, really. Your tech probably does it without your knowledge all the time if you aren't doing this work yourself. So you shouldn't freak out too much about it, as long as you're detail oriented. Right. Generally speaking, this stuff doesn't really get away from you. And I'm pretty detail oriented, if you haven't noticed. These things are great. I get these off of Amazon. They are just clear, flexible cutting boards is all they are. And whether it's doing this kind of work or fret dressing on guitars, you don't have to worry about sliding off with a file and gouging the top of the guitar, because even though this is very thin, lightweight, and transparent, it's extremely tough stuff. It ain't going nowhere. You can dig a file into that pretty hard and not do any damage to the guitar. Paper towel, then I'm gonna put underneath just to keep the fuzzies from getting everywhere. I like to go over the frets twice just to make sure I got a good shine on them. I'll get some light on here. I mean, these frets are in pretty good shape. Shouldn't take too much to bring them up. And before I went and did this project, this guitar had gotten a full level crown polish fret dressing done on it. So in reality, this is just to clean up whatever oxidation has occurred from not playing it. Pretty much that's all I'm doing. I'll just go down all 21 frets and back, and that'll be good to go. So I got it all polished up, and now I'm just gonna brush off the steel wool filings onto that little paper towel, and then get rid of all that mess into the garbage can so it doesn't get into the electronics. So this plastic has done its job, and if there's any leftover steel wool pieces after you brushed it all off, before you peel up your protection, you just take some tape and you'll pat it off and you'll get all of it. Plus I have some tape on the pickup, and you could put tape on the pickups if you didn't have this. Yeah, steel wool is really bad for your pickups. No doubt about it. I will not kid anybody and say, "No, it's fine." It's not fine. But you can still use it, get excellent results, and not mess anything up. You just gotta take precaution. Alrighty, last little piece of protection here. I still get this piece of plastic over the pickup, but nope, we're good to go. So, time to get lemon oil on that fretboard. Word of caution about lemon oil, especially on an ebony fretboard, make sure you're using actual lemon oil, not just the stuff that they've got for furniture, because it may have a lot of water in it and not so much oil. If it doesn't say on the label, just go find some somewhere else, or you can order it from companies like Stuart McDonald or, you know, Luthier Supply Company. Because the idea is you want the with open pore fingerboards like rosewood, palfaro. I think there's different types of rosewood, you know, that are substitutes for Indian rosewood. This neck is old enough that this is definitely Indian rosewood. Ebony's fairly tight, but you still want to treat it with like a lemon oil. If there's too much water in the lemon oil, you could cause the wood to actually, instead of be conditioned, you can create a problem where you you cause the wood fibers to expand outward and swell because of the presence of water. And that could create an issue with a fret. You know, it could push a fret out of alignment. And then you, instead of treating the fretboard to conditioning, you have now created a mechanical problem for your guitar, because now you have a high fret where before you did anything to it, it didn't. So make sure you're using actual lemon oil or whatever brand of fingerboard conditioner that is designed for use on guitars and not the furniture stuff. Furniture stuff is very, very cheap, but it may have a lot of water in it, so you gotta watch out. We'll let that soak in. I'll probably make another pass at it just to make sure it's got a good coverage, and I've conditioned the rosewood. Because just like an acoustic guitar, even on electrics, if you let this wood dry out, it could crack on you. Also, it looks better when it's got a nice dark finish to it than it does when it gets chalky when it's dried out. And, you know, you reduce the issues of cracking, frets shifting out of alignment, all the bad stuff that you don't want to happen. So, it's cheap insurance. Do it. Now, years ago, on this guitar, I actually made a bow nut for it. And I like to use this stuff from a company called Big Ben's Nut Sauce. So it's just a really good lube for the nut on the guitar, unless you have a graphite nut, and as opposed to putting, you know, pencil graphite on there. I mean, if the nut on the guitar is built correctly to begin with, you shouldn't have tuning stability issues. But if you're using a Bigsby, and in my case, coupling that with a B bender on top of the Bigsby, anything that you can do to combat string friction and ensure that the string doesn't hang up on the nut, therefore the guitar comes back to tune correctly. Obviously you want to try and give it every shot you possibly can. It's one of the reasons why we upgraded the Bigsby with the Callaham parts. Alrighty, so we're going with the GHS burnished nickel strings. And I've gone through this a couple of times before when I had a guitar channel, but I'm going to do it here real quick. I use a tape flag, and this guy is about, I don't know, 2 1/4 inches long. And what that does is it allows me to pre-measure the length of the string, so I can cut the string off without having to do any goofy tying off or any of that nonsense, and get just the right number of wraps. And this also works for the vintage style Clusen tuners, where the center, where the string actually pokes down through the center of the tuning machine. Let's get this guy all strung up so we can hear some awesome B bender Bigsby goodness. Probably one of the coolest things, I think, about this Callaham updated Bigsby with all these upgrade parts is this. You don't have to hook the ball end of the string on some roller pins anymore. All you have to do is just string it through and then string it through the string bar and then put it under the roller bar and then on through. And it holds itself in place because there's actually drilled and countersunk holes on the string bar instead of just roll pins. It makes life so much easier. Very cool, very cool. We've got these grooves to locate the strings in place, and it keeps them from moving side to side, which is really convenient if you're using a vintage style ashtray bridge on your Telecaster with a Bigsby. Now at this point, I'm just doing a standard, you know, restring of a guitar I just take my tape flag, measure it to the string post, hold on to it with my finger, pre-cut, then grab my string winder. Then I put just the tail end of the string, maybe about just over an eighth of an inch, not quite a quarter, into the center hole on the Clusen style tuner, and then just wind it up. So, real briefly here, it's probably like showing people how to chew bubble gum and walk at the same time. Anyhow, so real quickly, my tape flag, I measure it off the tail end of the tuning post I'm working on there. Pre-cut the string. I just kind of hold it next to the tuning post till it touches the bushing. And that kind of lets me know approximately how far it's got to go in the center hole of these vintage Clusen style tuners. And I'll do this one by hand just so you can see it. Life would be faster with a string winder, but normally if this was a string through tuner post, I would do one wrap above the tail and then the subsequent wraps below the tail. But in this case, because they're Clusen, you know, Fender Clusen style with the center hole there, you don't need to do that, and the hourglass will lock them in place. Obviously locking tuners are much faster to string up, but I hate when strings get tied. It doesn't really provide additional tuning stability, and it makes life so much more difficult when you take the strings off the guitar, because you run the risk of scratching the crap out of the peg face. So it's nice and neat, same number of windings, and you'll get that all the way down. It looks nice and professional, and even if you don't have these vintage style tuners, it still looks good, because they're all trimmed to the same length. Now, this length here may be different for different people, depending upon the tuning post style. Like I said, for me, it's about 2 1/4 inches, somewhere around there. And, you know, I've had this thing for years. It's just a scrap of string with a piece of tape on it, a little tape flag, and I keep it in my toolkit for when I restring. Easy peasy. All right, it's all strung up, and now I gotta do setup. Now I think what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna kinda do a rough setup real quick and then explain what I did. And then go and do a full setup video on a guitar at a later point, cause it's gonna take me a while to figure out exactly how the mechanics of this is supposed to work. It does come with instructions, but you kinda have to be a bit of an engineer to figure it out. I'm gonna get out my tools, a radius gauge, you know, various other things here, and go about setting up the guitar, getting it tuned, and once I figure out exactly how that dude works, we'll jump to the next bit. Wrestling with this for a good hour and a half, I finally got the guitar set up, the neck relief, the action where I wanted it. Remember, I got new saddles on this bridge, so things shifted a little bit. It also took me quite a while to figure out the B blender with the Bigsby. And then I just had to keep playing it until the strings settled into the point where it wanted to stay in tune. Now, it's still a little iffy on the tuning, but it's pretty close now. I think the more I play it, the more it'll stabilize out. So the B bender's still kind of going in and out of tune, and I only really know one little lick. It sounds and it plays really good. I'm quite happy with the result here. And when it's set up correctly, the Bigsby, the trem arm, kind of goes out of the way. The selector switch is kind of out of the way also. So it's got a good mellow tone. I really love the Seymour Duncan Pirelli Gates. At any rate, it'll be a little while till you see another video on this, because I need to practice and figure out how to use this damn thing. And of course, the vibrato still works with the Bigsby. That is a really, really slick setup, I gotta say, because it still works with the vibrato, and you can still do all the B-bender licks. So there's a bunch of Jimmy Page stuff There's a bunch of Clarence White stuff. There's a ton of country music that it opens yourself up to. You could do a lot of pedal steel sounding stuff. I might modify this arm a little bit. It feels a little long, but like I'm still figuring out how to play it. So I kind of have to leave well enough as it is for now and just get in there and practice, because I'm pretty much out of practice. But like, this is like a new dimension for playing, so I'm like learning some cool new stuff all over again, and it makes me want to, it motivates me to want to play. So thanks for watching. I really appreciate it. If you don't mind clicking the like and the subscribe button and the little bell icon for notifications so you know when another video comes out, whether it's guitar related or motorcycle related. Hopefully in the future when the weather warms up around here in Michigan, we'll be out in the garage doing other garage and motorcycle related stuff. Between now and then, I'm going to practice the guitar and do a good demo video of this on a much better amp than my little practice amp down here. But anyhow, thanks for watching. Much appreciated. Take it easy.